So, welcome everybody from my side as well. My name is Bernd Fix. I'm from the Valhalla Foundation in Germany. We are a civil rights movement foundation in the digital area. So we support any event and any activity around hacking, digital rights, cyber rights. And we are very, very happy to support the BalCCon conference now for the second year. And we will hope that this will become a permanent institution here in Serbia. So we are looking forward to do that for the next years as well. When Milos asked me to give a talk, I was actually not thought that it would be the first talk of the conference at all, which is normally a keynote, which is giving some general introduction into the topic. I've given a more socio-political talk last year, the last conference here, so I decided to make something more technical this year. So I hope I don't scare you off, because at least in the second part of my talk it's going to be a little bit technical. Maybe you do not have to study physics and quantum mechanics, but it certainly helps. But I try to make it as plain as possible so that at least you understand what this is all about. Because post-quantum crypto is not a very familiar term in the hacker community. So what is this all about? I mean, we are now about some 15 months into the revelations by Edward Snowden about the global surveillance, or the scale of the global surveillance. So we know that every digital communication we do today is actually monitored and recorded by secret agencies. And of course you can say, okay, if that's the case, what can we do about it? And there are two basic strategies to encounter this thing of surveillance. The first thing is to have confidence into the legal system and say, okay, there can be laws and regulations to control secret agencies so they do not spy on us. I think this approach is really foolish. Because public oversight and secret agencies, that's a contradiction in itself. That will never work. So there's only one way to encounter this surveillance, and this is by digital self-defense. We have to exercise digital self-defense for ourselves and others to protect our communication from being spied on. There is no other way around that. And it was Edward Snowden himself who in a very early interview once said, okay, encryption works. Probably implemented strong crypto systems are one of the few things you can rely on. So there are ways to countermeasure the global surveillance we are all under. But we have to take care of them ourselves. And these innocent looking words like probably implemented strong crypto, they sound like easy, but they are not. We will learn about that in a few minutes. But it's not only about good implemented crypto systems, people have to know how to use them as well. So one of the first things that was boosted by these things were the so-called crypto party movement, which started long before Snowden, but gained very much more importance since the Snowden revelations. Crypto parties are basically meetings where tech-savvy people like you go to a party with people who do not know much about computers or encryption, but want to learn how to protect their communication by encrypting email, and how to browse the web anonymously, things like that. How to use Tails to protect, to have a operating system available that protects you as much as possible. People have to learn about that, and you are the people, you are the hackers to teach other people how to do that. So I can only encourage everyone to organize and participate in crypto parties. That's a very, very important thing, and I think the last crypto party in Serbia is about a year ago, so I think it's time to have a new one. But, as I said, is that all? Do we only have to learn how to encrypt our email and then we are on the safe side? Honestly, you're not. Because there's one important thing, for example, about email encryption you have to know. Email encryption is only protecting the content of your email. It's not protecting the so-called metadata. It's not protecting whom you are sending the email to. It's not protecting the subject. It's not protecting that you are in communication with the person. And we know from statements from the NSA and from the CIA, they say we kill based on metadata. So they don't even need to read the content of your email to put you into a connection to people they find suspicious, make you a selector and look at you closer. So email encryption in itself is not, it's not the solution to everything. You have to know that there's a lot more about it. But it's the first good step. But we are here now all hackers, so I actually not only want to talk about the good things of crypto, because we have to realize that there are other things to be taken care of. Properly implemented strong crypto, as Snowden said, is very hard to achieve. And I'm here to warn you about the upcoming cryptocalypse. I'm here to tell you that within the next 10 years, we will have a disaster, a crypto disaster, because three important facts now work hand in hand towards this cryptocalypse. And I'm going to talk about these three points. The first thing, that basically all private communication that is encrypted, like OpenPGP email, where the body of the email is encrypted, and a lot of transient communication, so if you browse the website with SSL or TLS, is actually missing a very, very important cryptographic feature, which is called perfect forward secrecy. What does perfect forward secrecy mean? It means if you encrypt an email, if you encrypt stuff, you use a private key, or at least you can decrypt it with a private key. And whenever this private key is broken, any communication you did in the past is readable. So the disaster not only happens for future communication with a broken key, but if your key gets broken in 5 years, things you encrypt today or can decrypt today can be read by your adversaries. And a good crypto system does not allow that. A good crypto system has perfect forward secrecy. So if a key gets broken, you can't use it for future encryptions. But it does not help anyone to read your communication in the past. But email does not allow that. So basically everything we send encrypted over email today is lacking this feature. And that's one of a problem. And the second part of it, basically most of these encrypted communication is actually stored long-term by secret agencies. So the NSA, for example, has one installation, one facility, which is probably well-known, which is Bluffdale in Utah, which is a data center where they are about to store, well, we can only estimate how much data they can store, but it's probably about a yottabyte. And the yottabyte is something most of you have probably heard about it. So imagine you have a terabyte hard disk. And for every byte on the terabyte hard disk, you have another terabyte hard disk. So that's the size of a yottabyte. So you can store years of complete internet communication in this facility. And what they actually do, everything they can't decrypt today, they store there. Of course, in the future, they probably can, because do you remember, we have this missing feature of perfect forward secrecy. So if they are able to break keys in the future, they can read backwards communication. And there's still a lot of intelligence to be gained from encrypted email or encrypted other forms of communication, which is 2, 3, 4, 5 years old. And the third point is that I strongly believe that most public key crypto systems that we use today will be broken within the next 10 years. And I mean completely broken. Because the advancements in quantum computers, as I will show you later, will allow owners of crypto, of quantum computers, to break current public key systems on a large scale within reasonable time. So all these three factors together will lead us to the cryptocalypse I'm talking about. And obviously, we can't do anything about the second point. I mean, they will store this information, this encrypted information. We can't prevent them from doing that. The only things where we can actually act is the first part, and this is the third part. So there are two things we actually need to right now. First of all, we have to stop using cryptosystems that do not provide perfect forward secrecy. We have to stop using email encryption as soon as possible and switch to systems that provide this important cryptographic feature of perfect forward secrecy, like PONT. Many people have not heard about PONT. I would be happy to talk to you after the talk, give an introduction to PONT, maybe have a little crypto party even. So there are ways around using email. There are ways of having a secure asynchronous communication. The same is true for TLS, SSL. So if you own a known web server, make sure you're using a crypto scheme, a cipher suite that actually only allows perfect forward secrecy encryption. Get rid of RC4, get rid of anything that does not use ephemeral keys. So that's what you can do immediately right now. And the second thing is, which is this talk is about, that is basically to design, implement, and deploy crypto systems that cannot be broken by quantum computers. Because, as we will see, we have a lot of different public key crypto systems like RSA, we have elliptic curve cryptography, we have Palier, Elgamal. So cryptographers know a lot of crypto systems, but all are based on the same mathematical principle, as we will see. And this common mathematical principle can be broken on a quantum computer. So we need to design new quantum safe algorithms that we can implement now, deploy now, and use whenever quantum computers are ready. So now it's getting a little bit technical. I hope at least the basic mathematical processes are clear. If you do not understand everything, it doesn't matter. If there's something very important, I will tell you that this is important to know. And if you cannot follow the mathematical line, believe me, or learn it, which would be even better. I would talk, what are the existing public key crypto systems we have today? How can we break them in the classical approach and with quantum computers? And how would quantum safe or quantum resistant cryptographic methods look like? So let's start with RSA. RSA is that what you normally use if you encrypt your email, or a lot of crypto based on the internet is based on RSA, which is the abbreviation for the three people who invented this algorithm, Rivest, Shamir, and Edelman. But as we will see, that was happening in 1977. The mathematical grounds for it were actually laid by Fermat and Euler in the late 18th, early 19th century. So we could have had public key cryptos some 200 years ago, but we were lacking the computers to do that. But the mathematical grounds were already there. So how does an RSA algorithm work? You start with two very large prime numbers, P and Q. A prime number, as you know, is a number that can only be divided by itself or one, but has no other divider. And then you multiply these two large prime numbers to get a number M, which is called the modulus. And the point is that you then compute a number R as the product of P minus 1 and Q minus 1. And R can only be computed by the knowledge of R and Q. So if someone only knows M, he has no chance to compute R out of M without knowing P, the prime factors P and Q. And if you use this number R, you can actually find a number that encrypts basically to itself in the exponentiation process. If you have this number R, you can choose a so-called public exponent E and compute a private exponent D by using this equation. And if you have that, then you have generated a public key pair. That's what you use in the in a public key encryption system. You have a private key that only you know and that you can use to decrypt messages that other people encrypt to you or for you with a public key. That's very important. So you have two keys, a public key that you can share with others, and this public key can be used by the others to send you encrypted emails or messages, and only you can decrypt them with a private key. So encryption is basically just a simple mathematical operation. You have the message A you want to encrypt. You do an exponentiation with the public exponent E, and then compute a modulus M. What does modulus mean? I mean, look at the clock, and only imagine you only have the second hand. No minutes and no hours. You have only the seconds. So you have 60 seconds on the clock, right? So if you are at 58 seconds and at 10 seconds, you are not at 68, but you are at 8 seconds because it wraps around after the 60. So that's the so-called modulus operation. And the same thing is actually employed in the RSA process as well. And decryption is basically using the ciphertext B with a private exponent D modulus M to result into the original plain text again. You can do it in the other sequence, then it's called the so-called signature. It's the digital signature people talk about. So if you sign a message to make sure that you are the sender, you are the originator of a message. That's basically the same process, but you switch D and E in the sequence. So you encrypt with your private key and have other people verify your signature by using the public exponent or the public key. So the security of RSA, which is derived from this formula, is actually based on a problem which is called discrete logarithm problem. You see this operation here is an exponentiation. You say a to the power of d. And the logarithm is basically the inverse mathematical operation. And if you use that in the normal world, if you have a number and you exponentiate it and take the result, then you can compute the inverse pretty easily. You can actually do the logarithm to find out what is the base. But that's not possible if you have this modulo M operation here, which is called the discrete logarithm problem over finite fields. So this additional term here makes it impossible to do logarithm as we would do it in the normal way. So the problem, the RSA security is based on, is called discrete logarithm problem. But what about other cryptosystems like elliptic curve cryptography, which is invented some 10 years later? This is basically more a graphical thing. Elliptic curve, a curve, of course, is something you draw on a 2D plane, for example. It's a continuous curve. And you have a function, or you have an equation describing the curve. It's not a function, but it's a curve description. So it looks very, very simple. You have two variables, A and B, so you can have different curves for different parameters. Let's look at one curve you've probably heard of. That's the Bitcoin curve. Bitcoin is this cryptocurrency everyone is talking about. So it's not using RSA as its basic encryption scheme, but it's using elliptic curves. And I've drawn the Bitcoin curve here, which is the very simple formula that y squared is x cubed plus 7. That sounds very, very easy, but nonetheless it's very, very hard because x and y, the coordinates of the curve, have to be integers. I mean, of course, you can have any x-y combination that lies on the curve where x and y are not integers, but if you restrict them to integers, it's a little bit more complicated. So how does elliptic curve crypto work? Basically, very similar to how RSA works. So you have a point on the curve. You see, you select a random point on the curve, which with coordinates that are integers, And then you can derive any other point on the curve by multiplying or by adding it, this point with itself multiple times. So you get certain properties that all points on the curve have a special form, which is mathematically similar to the RSA exponentiation. So it's easy to compute the multiple of a point G, so by adding G A times with itself, but it's impossible to compute this factor from P and G alone. So you have a basic homomorph equation to the RSA situation. So this is also a discrete logarithm problem. But it's actually a little bit harder to solve than in the case of RSA, which allows smaller, shorter keys for ECC. That's why ECC is so attractive for cryptographers, because it allows you to work with so much smaller keys than RSA. So if you want to have a secure RSA key, nowadays you should use at least 2048 bits, better even 4096 bits, but you're pretty safe with around 256 bits for ECC keys. Okay, so we see it's basically the same problem, the same mathematical problem to be solved here to break this crypto system. And that's true for any other crypto system based on the same mathematical hardness, like El-Gamal or Diffie-Hellman for the key exchange. I think we can skip this easily, but we can see it's basically very analogous, and it's always the same mathematical problem to be solved. So how do you break RSA or ECC or any other discrete logarithm problem? Well, as I said, you have to reverse this equation, and that's very, very, very hard, because there are no very efficient mathematical problems to do that. Mathematicians call these kind of problems trapdoor problems. It's easy to fall into a trapdoor, but it's very hard to get out of them. So it's easy to compute them in one way, but it's very hard to compute them in the other way. So there are algorithms that work for small numbers, so it's easy to do that for 100-bit numbers or 120-bit numbers, but it's getting harder and harder when the key size increases. So for RSA, for example, people do not even try to solve the discrete logarithm problem anymore. They say, okay, for RSA we have a shortcut, we only need to factorize the modulus m. M is a well-known, it's a published number, so everyone can see that. So if we find the two prime numbers that actually make up m, we can circumvent the discrete logarithm problem and compute R by just knowing P and Q. So that's the way RSA is normally attacked. That does not work for ECC, by the way. There are different ways on how to do that. I don't want to go too deep into that. So until now, you can officially, RSA keys can be broken if they are less than or around 800 bits. Some people say that agencies like the NSA or the Chinese government has ways to factorize 1024-bit RSA keys. Maybe they do, but it's pretty sure they can't break RSA 2048 or even larger keys. But that was only until 1994. Until then, the world for RSA and ECC was fine. Well, then came a physicist called Peter Shor, and he said, I can program a quantum computer, which at that time was more or less science fiction. I can program a quantum computer to solve or to break RSA keys and ECC keys within reasonable time. And I mean, he was writing basically an algorithm on a computer that does not actually exist. That was funny in itself. It was completely abstract, it was completely theoretical, and everyone said, yeah, nice idea, good to know, but what's the use of it? Because we do not have quantum computers, so why should we care? And nobody cared. Since 20 years, basically nobody cared because everybody says quantum computers, that's Star Trek, that's science fiction, that will never happen. But the developments in the last years actually contradict that approach. There is a company in the US called N-Wave System, which is actually selling operational quantum computers with 1,000 qubits to institutions like the NASA, not the NSA, the NASA, to a lot of research institutions. I have to say that these computers are not ideal quantum computers. They operate on a certain principle called adiabatic, which means there is no energy exchange, so it limits the number of algorithms you can run on them. You can run some optimization algorithms on them pretty fine, which would take years or centuries on a normal computer and can be solved within hours on a quantum computer. But I'm sure that it's only an engineering problem to get these 1,000 qubit, existing qubit quantum computers into quantum computers that can run Shor algorithms and break RSA keys. And if you have you can always have two kinds of problems in this field. You can have a theoretical problem and you can have an engineering problem. If you have a theoretical problem, you can never be sure that it's going to be solved within reasonable time. And you cannot solve it by putting more people on it. But if you have an engineering problem, that's a problem you normally can solve by just putting more money into it and putting more people to work on it, because that's something that can be much easier solved than any theoretical problem. And I'm convinced that building real quantum computers that can run Shor algorithms is an engineering problem. So I'm convinced that within the next 10 years we will have quantum computers of reasonable size that can break real-world crypto systems. I mean, we now have experimental quantum computers. IBM, for example, built one who can run Shor algorithms, but only with, I think, about 5 or 6 bits, which is, of course, ridiculous. So they can factor, for example, the number 15 into 3 and 5. I mean, every kid having this normal 101 can do that in his head, so you don't need a quantum computer for it. But it proves the theory works, and it's only a question of how to scale this into real quantum computers. So how do quantum computers work? Quantum computers, and that's the funny thing about it, they are fuzzy. Quantum computers means that a quantum state can have two different states at the same time. These states are caught in superposition. So it's not one or zero, like in the normal quantum computer, it's one and zero at the same time for a quantum computer. And only through certain kinds of measurements you estimate if it's really a zero or really a one. So you can implement quantum bits. That's the equivalent of a normal bit for a quantum computers. Mostly it's done like with superconducting loops, which are called Josephine junctions. You put it into a very low temperature, just basically about little above 0 degree Kelvin, milli degrees above Kelvin. And then the electricity in these superconducting loops can flow without any resistance, so it starts to flow basically immediately. And it can flow either clockwise or counterclockwise, and these are the two superimposed states of a quantum bit. So engineers now know how to produce these kind of qubits basically on a large scale. I mean, it's a production process that is well known. It can be repeated easily with thousands of these Josephine junctions on a chip or in a row. But the point is, if you have 1,000 of these things in a row, that doesn't make you a quantum computer of 1,000 bits. No, it makes you 1,000 quantum computer with one bit. So the actual challenge here, and that's what I would call the engineering problem, is to link these qubits together into one coherent state, into one common quantum state. And once you achieve that, you can run the quantum algorithms I was talking about. So I don't want to talk about how it basically works. That's very, very technical. So you can use electromagnetic fields to put the qubit into certain states you want it to have. But I want to talk about quantum gates. Quantum gates are basically the equivalent of gates in a normal computer. Probably you know that the computer is based on certain gates like AND and NOR and stuff like that. And you have similar gates for quantum computers. The classic computer has a NOT gate, an AND gate, an OR gate. And every other gate can be basically reconstructed by combining these kind of gates. In a quantum computer, there is a restriction. Because only reversible operations are possible in the quantum computers, certain states would not be possible. I mean, to invert a state, that's reversible, because if you know the result, you can make a conclusion what the input was. But if you have an AND gate, you cannot deduct the input from the output. So you cannot have an AND gate on a quantum computer. That's not possible. So you need different gates on a quantum computer, but people did that and invented three types of gates and can make a proof that these three gates are sufficient to build a universal computer. And if you can build a universal computer, it means that you can run any algorithm on it that a computer can run. So, and if you use these gates, you can do composite gates, doing more complex computations. So you can build algorithms from these gates that solve much more complicated processes. So let's look, how does the Shor algorithm for a quantum computer works? How can a quantum computer actually solve the problem of the discrete logarithm? I mean, what we are actually looking for is something that solves the problem of factorization. So we are looking for a number that fulfills a certain property in regard of the modulus m. That's the number we want to factorize. And the quantum step, the whole algorithm involves four steps, but not all of them are quantum computer based. So three of them are actually done on a normal computer, and only one of them is running on a quantum computer. And that's what the quantum computer is really good at, is looking at periods of groups and cycles in groups. So you do not solve the problem by looking at the factorization itself. You try to find the period induced by the factorization. So that's what the quantum computer is actually good at. So it's basically not a factoring problem, but an order finding problem, which is much more suitable for quantum computers. The point is, then, that's something a lot of people do not realize. They think, oh, quantum computers, they are great machines, so whenever I do a computation on a quantum computer, I got the right result. No, you probably don't. If you're running Shor's algorithm, about 50% of your solutions are shit. They are the trivial solution, they are a solution that does not match, a solution that does not help you in any way. So you have to run it a second time. And the second thing is that quantum mechanical computers are not fast. That's something people always thought, oh, quantum computers, they are instantaneous. You put something in and you get a result out immediately. No, they actually take a lot of time, much longer than normal computers actually do for a single operation. So it takes some time for a quantum computer to actually do its computation. So running the Shor algorithm is not very fast, but it's very efficient. Because if 50% of their solutions are correct, you probably need two runs, or basically three runs, to get the right result. And then if every round takes 30 minutes, who cares? I mean, it's still still much faster than waiting centuries for the result on a normal computer. Okay, so now we have one problem, and one additional problem. If you can influence the way crypto algorithms are defined, you can actually even make it easier for you to break quantum to break crypto systems. And that's what the NSA did. And it didn't start with doing that since the Snowden revelations. It did that from the earliest time of computing. Probably a lot of people of you heard of DES, Data Encryption Standard. That was the standard for data encryption in the 1970s until the 1980s. And it was originally designed to have 128 bits key size. But then the NSA influenced the standardization process and reduced the key size to 56 bits. So they were always interested in having crypto systems that are easy to break. And they did the same with the ECC, with the elliptic curve cryptography based for the NIST curves. So they said, okay, if you want to standardize elliptic curve cryptography, we tell you which curves to use. And nobody knows, except Bruce Schneier, and he's not going to tell us, what is the reason why the curves are as they are, which are used in elliptic curve cryptography today. We have strong evidence from what Bruce Schneier says. He's not telling much, but he's seen the original documents, and he says, I would not trust them. And if he says he would not trust them, I think it's good for us not to trust them as well. So even without quantum computers, some of the ECC curves are probably broken, so can be easily decrypted by NSA or other agencies with the experience and knowledge behind it. So actually, these guys both broke the internet, because for us, it means we cannot use secure crypto. So we need a new one, and we need not only a new one, we need one that is resistant to quantum computers. We need one that is developed as free and open source software, so that nothing, really nothing inside the algorithm or how the program or how the crypto system works is hidden from public knowledge, is subject to audit by anyone who wants to look into it. Can have an open peer review within the crypto community, so have as many people look at it as possible. And simply ignore commercial or industrial standardization. I mean, it makes no sense that a few people decide on what should be used. If there is a group of people to decide what's to be used, it's the users. Let the users decide, let the community decide which crypto algorithms should be really used and which should be not be used. Do not trust in government or industrial standardization. So, do we have alternatives? When I said that since 1994, when Shor came up with this crypto algorithm, with this quantum algorithm, nobody cared. That's not completely true. Some nerds in the crypto community took that serious and started to work on algorithms that cannot be broken by quantum computers. But until now, nobody believed in them, nobody cared what they were doing. It's just now that people start to take care. There are different mathematical problems, like the discrete logarithm problem, but not breakable by quantum computers, that can be used. One of them is the so-called lattice-based crypto. A lattice-based crypto is basically, let's imagine a 2D plane, and you have points in these 2D planes that can be addressed by two different vectors. So you can reach any point in this lattice by adding a combination of so-called base vectors. Now the point in these lattices is you can have a good base, which is small and probably orthogonal as much as possible, and you can have bad bases. And a bad base in the system can be used as a public key, and the good base can be used as a private key, because there are problems, mathematical problems, you can define on such a lattice that are easily solvable if you know a good base, and that are very hard to solve if you know the bad base. So you can use these kinds of problems in the lattice. So something like shortest vector problems. So you have a point and you look for the shortest vector in the lattice to another point, which is easily solvable with a good base, but hard to solve with a bad base. Or if you have a point that is not exactly in the lattice, like this one, and you try to find the lattice point closest to this point, that's also a problem that is easily solvable with a good base, but hard to solve with a bad base. So you can use these kinds of problems to create a cryptosystem. And there is one that uses that, it's called Entru, which is terribly, terribly complicated. I mean, I only want to show you this is based on truncated polynomial rings. That's something that even most mathematicians don't even understand. So it's something very few people can look into, right? Very few people can check if this cryptosystem makes sense, if it's secure against attacks and stuff like that. Therefore, it disqualifies itself. And Andrew has that problem. Every time a mathematician decided to look into it, he found something that broke the system. I mean, they fixed it afterwards, but every time someone looked, he found a problem. That's not a good choice for a crypto system. It was actually patented as well, so it was not open source software. For whatever reason, I don't know what drove Richard Stallman to make a dual license agreement with the company, so they released it to the open source community. But prevent you from giving it away or make commercial software and stuff like that. Very, very strange agreement. I wouldn't trust it. Forget about Entru. There's one system I want to go a little bit deeper into it because it's very, very easy to understand for computer programmers. It's easy to understand, it's much easier than RSA or ECC. I mean, I noticed a lot of you were a little bit bored with the mathematical presentation of how RSA and ECC work. I understand that. This is much more easier because it's much closer to how computers work. And it's based on binary codes. And binary codes is something that computer users are used to. A binary code, for example, is used for error correction. So you put in a sequence of bits, and you get an output of more bits, which has an error correction code in it. So if in the transmission of this sequence, a bit flips by random chance, you can still reconstruct the original sequence easily from the rest of the bits. So you can detect there was a transmission error, and you can actually correct it. And you can use these error correction schemes to construct crypto schemes, which is very interesting. So it's basically, abstractly, it's built on a matrix, G, where you put in your initial sequence vector, the vector of n bits, of k bits, and you get out an output of n bits. And then you have an efficient decoding algorithm as well. So you get the n bits in and get the k bits out again, error corrected. So that's very well-known computer science theory. Error correction codes is basically, very well understood. And if you have these kinds of matrices, like Hamming code matrices, you can construct a crypto algorithm out of it. I will show you how that works. You construct this binary matrix that can correct error codes, that can correct transmission errors, and accept for a given size of input, it can correct a certain number of faulty bits. Then you construct a random matrix, which is invertible, it only needs to be invertible. You construct a permutation matrix, which is basically just switching bit positions in a sequence and compute the product of these matrices, and this is your public key. And the private key is the single matrices you have here. And that's all you need to construct a public key crypto system out of it. So you can use encryption by using the public key. So you have a k-bit message you want to be encrypted. You compute the n-bit from the matrix k. Then you construct a random bit vector, so that's the error vector. So you introduce a random error into your message and compute the ciphertext out of it. And the decryption is able to basically get the error of the transmission out because it knows the error correction code based on the private key. So it can easily decode the original of the ciphertext message into the plaintext message again. So that's something you can easily implement on a computer. So you need only how to do binary codes, how to use binary matrices, how to multiply a vector with a matrix and stuff. And it works. And it's quantum computer resistant. The only disadvantage of such a system is that the key gets really, really large. So half a megabyte for a key is quite common in such system. But nowadays, I think transferring half a megabyte of key once shouldn't be the main problem. If it prevents us from being subject to the cryptocalypse because quantum computers can break the code. Okay. Anyone who's interested, I'm happy to go into the details. But of course, I'm happy to take any question right now as well.
With the message-based crypto, code-based crypto, don't the messages also get really large due to the additional error?
Yes, the messages get blown up, like in Paillet. So if you have an n-bit input, you can have a longer output that needs to be transmitted. But that's usually less than a factor two.
Sorry, I'll try to talk a bit louder. Code-based in crypto, is it also possible to implement that in an FPGA to make it very fast compared to computational computing?
Yeah, I think there is no operation in it that's not implementable on an FPGA. It should be easy to be produced on an ASIC as well. As I said, it's no complicated mathematical procedure. It's really straightforward binary codes.
You said that the time to run one quantum computer operation is very long. Is that an engineering problem or is it a physical problem?
And it's a question of how the quantum computer works. I mean, as I said, these Enshu systems, quantum computers that are actually deployed today, they work adiabatic, which means with no energy exchange with the environment. And if you have transformation state changes in the quantum state, in that way, they can only go very, very slow. So an ideal quantum computer can work faster than an adiabatic quantum computer, but it's still in the area of seconds and minutes than in nanoseconds.
And also, you said that we can use a perfect forward secrecy to protect our traffic. But if we have a quantum computer, all the schemes we use for forward secrecy right now are breakable. There's
elliptic
crypto, and that's it. So,
if we use RSA keys in a perfect forward secrecy scheme, and if the quantum computer can break that keys, we cannot use them in the future. But all our past communication would be safe.
But if we have that recorded, we can use the quantum computer on that communication, and we still can break it.
No. No, because that involves random numbers only known to the peers, which are not transmitted. So you have information going into the cipher process that is not transmitted and therefore cannot be recorded by the agencies.
No, what you usually use there is Diffie-Hellman, right? You negotiate the formal secrets using Diffie-Hellman.
Yes, they need to break Diffie-Hellman. That's right. Diffie-Hellman, that's right. That's true. Yeah, you're correct. Yeah.
So for code-based crypto, can you just tell us what are the typical, say, parameters? I'm just trying to imagine the size of, you know, this error detection or correction code.
Okay, the they are less investigated, like as RSA, for example. But the implementations I've seen work on matrices that are about 2 or 4 K. That take chunks of 2 or 4 K input data. So
G is 2 K.
Yeah, but the key size, of course, is the matrix.
Yeah.
So it's 2,000 by 2,000 bits. Which is much more, much longer than the normal key.
Then encryption takes 2 kilobits, outputs 4 kilobits, then you modify 2,000 random bits out of this, and that will be transmitted. Like half of the bits you modify, half of the bits you insert there.
Well, the key is the matrix, and the input and the output is 2 different.
I'm just wondering about the size of the.
Okay, so let's say you normally do not put twice as much as output. Let's say you put 2,000 bits in and 2,500 bits out. So you have a matrix of 2,000 by 2,500, right, which is 5 million bits. So you have a key size of 5 million bits. One more question?
We've heard that the secret agencies, for example, the NSA, don't already have quantum computers. For example, they can have them, but they're just keeping it secret.
Yes, that's what everyone suspects. It's hard to tell. We know that the NSA is actually financing universities working in the field of quantum computers, which does not mean they do not have their own a group of experts working on it. It's very hard to tell. It's very hard to tell.
Well, am I understood correctly that the main problem of reading the state of qubits already solved, not in theory but in a low-cost practical way?
It depends on how the qubit is created. I mean, you can have different physical things like ion catches or photons or Josephson junctions in basically zero Kelvin. It depends on how you implement your qubit. But the Jefferson thing is basically well understood and works pretty well.
Okay, and what's the last success experiments and the biggest number of qubits?
The N-Wave system actually has 1,000 qubits in one computer. But as I said, they are working adiabatic. They can't run Shor. They only run adiabatic optimization algorithms. But that's the size that's manufacturable. And they double the number of qubits basically every 6 months. That's over the last years.
The biggest one, as I know, that can run Shor's algorithm was 4 qubits. According to public data, the biggest quantum computer that can run Shor's algorithm to factor numbers is 4 qubits. So,
the result was 4 qubits, but you need 8 qubits to run it because you need 2 registers in the algorithm. But so it's very 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 small indeed compared to that. But as I said, I'm convinced it's an engineering problem to entangle these qubits to get a real quantum computer. Okay, thank you very much for this more technical question.